Hi, everyone, and welcome to another episode of The Safe Space. Today, we will be talking about resources in the community school to help parents after sexual assault. My name is Brandi Lowery, and I'm a staff attorney at Lone Star Legal Aid. I am in the Individual Safety Unit in Houston, Texas. Before we get started, let me read our disclaimer. This presentation is intended to serve as legal information and does not replace legal advice. Contact Lone Star Legal Aid at 1-800-733-8394 or go to www.lonestarlegalaid.org for more information on legal assistance. Lone Star Legal Aid does not discriminate on the basis of race, color, religion, gender, gender expression, sexual orientation, age, national origin, ancestry, disability, marital status, or military status in any of its activities or operation. Again, as I mentioned, we are going to discuss resources in the community school to help parents after sexual assault. I believe this is a good topic because, as you know, school is getting ready to get started. So it would be a great way for parents to know and have resources if their child in any way has been affected in sexual assault. But we also want to introduce our two wonderful guests. They are not necessarily Dallas-based, but Dallas-born. Like, people know I'm originally from Dallas, even though I live here in Houston. And so it's a wonderful opportunity to have people from Dallas on at the same time. So Hannah, introduce yourself to everybody.
Yes, thanks, Brandi. I'm Hannah Cramer. I'm a staff attorney at Texas RioGrande Legal Aid, and I practice education law as part of my practice. And I did grow up in the Dallas area, specifically Plano, Frisco, and I've been in Central Texas for about 10 years now.
Well, wow. And then I want to introduce Andrew Harden, who is, we are childhood friends. Been knowing each other since we were like babies. So it is an honor to have you on the show as well. So introduce yourself, Andrew.
Yes, my name is Andrew Harden, the student culture coach here in a school district in the DFW Metroplex. This is currently my 18th year in education. And to be honest with you, I'm glad we're talking about this because this is not a racial problem. It's not a socioeconomic problem or anything like that. It's something that is all in our neighborhoods, all of our communities, and all in our schools. So for that reason, I'm glad that we're actually talking about this. So thanks a lot for having us talk about the subject.
Well, thank you both for being here. So as we know, this is a broad topic, and we're going to basically discuss mainly the elementary school age, middle and high school kids. But you know, this also happens on the college level. And we actually did a Title IX episode where we focused more on college. So now we're going to focus more on, like I said, the middle school, elementary, and high school. So we have a couple of scenarios that we're going to tackle. I mean, because like I said, it's broad, but we also want to make sure that people take away and are educated about this topic. So we're going to call them scenario one, scenario two, scenario three. But before, I'm going to give different scenarios. So like I said, it seems like there are several scenarios in which a school may have interaction with a student survivor who is a minor child. For instance, the abuser is another student on campus and the school is the one who discovers the abuse. Another situation is the abuser is another student on campus, but the abuse is reported first to someone else. Mm-hmm. Another situation, the abuser is not a student and the child makes an outcry to a school employee, and the abuser is not a student, the child makes an outcry off campus and the parents or guardians want to inform the school for supportive services. So first we're going to talk about just the standard, and this is for both of y'all. Is there a standard definition of sexual assault used by Texas school districts? And I'm going to let Hannah go first from the legal standpoint.
Yeah. So for K through 12, the Texas Association of School Boards maintains a policy online for public school districts. And so this is where I go to find a specific Texas district school's policy. And they have different acronyms but that's not the right word. For example, the sexual harassment policy is called the FFI policy. The FFI policy doesn't stand for anything. That's just how TASB identifies the policies. And most schools have the exact same FFI policy. So I pulled the definition for sexual harassment from my local school district in San Antonio, but I'll bet that it's the same for Richardson ISD where Andrew's in. So sexual harassment of a student by a district employee includes both welcome and unwelcome sexual advances, requests for sexual favors, sexually motivated physical, verbal, or nonverbal conduct, or other conduct or communication of a sexual nature where a district employee causes the student to believe that the student must submit to the conduct in order to participate in the school program or activity, or that that employee will make an educational decision like playing in sports or the student's grades based on whether or not the student submits to the conduct. And then also there's also student-on-student sexual harassment that follows a very similar definition. And the standard is that the conduct, the sexual harassment, is so severe, persistent, or pervasive that it affects the student's ability to participate in or benefit from an educational program or activity, like the classroom, sports, extracurricular activities. It affects the student's educational opportunities. It creates an intimidating, threatening, hostile, or abusive educational environment. So that includes gender-based harassment, harassment because of a student's gender identity or sexual orientation. And then of course, like physical sexual assault, like somebody might think when you like stereotypically sexual assault.
I'm on mute. Andrew, did you want to add to any of the definitions? Like what do y'all consider in Richardson ISD, you know, sexual harassment or sexual assault?
Well, it's pretty much the exact same thing in that regard. You know, every district has their own sets and all rules and policies or what have you. Us in particular, if we even have to, if we know about assault of that nature, we immediately have to report that and go to our Title IX director that actually handles all of that. So for the most part, just like you were saying earlier, I'm pretty sure, I'm not familiar off the top of my head, the exact definition, but we always go into along with state requires. So as far as what we do in the district, I'm pretty sure it's the exact same thing that what we just heard just a minute ago.
Okay. So let's focus on going to scenario one. When we said that the abuser is another student on campus and the school is the one who discovers the abuse. So what forms of sexual assault do you see most commonly perpetrated against school-aged children by other students? So Andrew, this was probably more like in regards to you since you're on campus.
Right. For the most part, some of the things that we have heard so far, you know, the touching, of course, you know, the verbal abuse for the most part. But the biggest thing that the biggest misconception is that it takes a lot for a child to open up. What I do right now as a culture coach, my whole thing is dealing with the emotional part of the child. Because, you know, when things are like this happen, it's very traumatic and it's very hard for us to understand the difference between emotional support and actually talking about that. So what we hear periodically is what I just said earlier, as far as the touching and things of that nature. And if we actually hear of that, we are bound to make sure we make a report of that. And as I said earlier, our school district makes sure that we have training so that all of our educators can actually be, they actually have some type of experiences in knowing what to do when this happens. And for the most part, it is a process that we actually really don't get into. We have a set section of a group that handles that. So all we can do is support and report it. And then after that, they take care of all of that. But for the most part, that's all you hear, or that's what we see basically on that, is some forms of that. And understanding the signs and symptoms, that's the biggest thing that we have to be aware of and make sure that we know that that's available right there. So that's for the most part, that's about it, really. All we have to do is just understand the functions to perform if a disclosure is made to us. And we do that every year. And matter of fact, that's what's happening now. We have, you know, we're about to start the school year up again. And right now, all of our educators are going through training to actually talk about that at this time.
And Hannah, what are some of the, so do you deal with a lot of school age children?
Yeah, we do with our education team. And I would say the most common thing also is inappropriate touching. I think especially in elementary school, that's what I see. And then at the high school, it's a lot of gender identity or sexual orientation based harassment, which wouldn't be so, I mean, that's still sex harassment, but it's not, I wouldn't consider that physical assault or sexual assault, but I see a lot of that at the high school level.
Okay. Andrew, you pointed out, and I want to talk about this, you said the signs. So what are some of the signs that you see? Because, like, you know, it starts at your level before it comes to, like, either Hannah or I, when we deal with the, like, the cases, you know, a lot of times, of course, it gets reported to the school. So what signs are y'all trained to see for a child that's been sexually assaulted or harassed?
Some of them could be, you know, looking for significant changes in behavior, reverting back to behaviors that they are outgrown, such as bedwetting and sucking of thumbs and things of that nature. Unexplained changes in their emotional state as far as anger and depression. Sexual behavior inappropriate for the age. You know, you don't want to have a pre-K or a kinder first, second talking about that. Or if they do, you tend to figure out, like, okay, where are they getting that information from? Sex is talking about sex, fear of refusing to be alone with someone by themselves, with or a specific person, being selective in some instances. Those are the signs that we have been trained to look out for in that regard. So the biggest thing here, we just need to make sure that all of those are traumatic experiences. And when a child trusts you to tell you those things, it is very important for us to create a safe environment so they have the opportunity to do so. So that's exactly what we do here. And that's honestly one of my roles here on this campus is to actually help out and actually teach and train individuals on that matter.
So then once a student comes to you and has reported or you see the signs, then, like, what's next? Not even necessarily you, just employee. So it's been reported. Then what's the next step?
The next step is actually to just listen first, listen intentionally and demonstrate compassion and understanding, because as I mentioned earlier, it's very traumatic. So after we get all of that and get the details, we immediately have to report it to our superiors. We have a coordinator, that handles that in our district. And soon as we turn that over to them, they actually handle that whole process. The biggest thing that we could do, and that's what we do periodically, is just to give assurance that we are talking about the abuse and them talking to the children, saying that, hey, this is the right thing to do to talk about it and tell them that it's not their fault, that and praise them for their bravery for actually doing so, because that is actually hard. To be honest with you, that happened to me when I was younger, but I was afraid to actually talk about that, you know, and to now I have the, you know, I have the resources and I can actually talk about it now, but as a child, you're scared to do that. So the biggest thing is to creating a safe space. And once you create the safe space and gain their trust, then report that to the proper authorities and they'll take care of from there.
So then, Hannah, in your experience, have you had any of your experience where the child may bypass the school and, like, you know, come to y'all directly?
So, I mean, as a lawyer, most of the cases I see are the child told the parent and the parents mm-hmm. calling us. So that's really all that's what my experience is. And so, yeah, I do see those cases where child tells the parent or parent sees a change, just like exactly like the things Drew mentioned, where a child is regressing and now they're wetting the bed, or they won't let mom and dad help change them or, like, help them pick out their clothes. It's things like that. There's been a big change in behavior, and parents find out, and then they come to me and they say, you know, what do we do?
Mm-hmm. That's what I get too. I get a lot where they told the parent and the parent comes to us as well. Mm-hmm. But with Andrew, so since in regards to that, then the child has been molested or what, you know, sexually assaulted, sexually harassed, and it hasn't came to us. So like the child, so like for instance, where they don't come to us yet, but now you have to tell the parent. How do you go, what is the process that the school takes to tell the parents that their child has experienced that?
It's just that. Normally it's a simple phone call that they're actually gathering. And what we do is we provide services or try to offer services for that sense, because that's a hard thing to stomach and actually process. And at the end of the day, that's exactly what happens. We notify our superiors, we bring the parents in and actually talk about that situation and try to help them understand what's wrong. And after that, that is it, is out of our hands. We have nothing else to deal with that. As I mentioned earlier, the biggest thing is just making sure the opportunity or the space is safe so that everyone is comfortable actually discussing it, because that's a hard topic to talk about.
So in your experience, what are some of the responses that parents get when they find out that their child has been sexually assaulted or harassed on campus?
Well, it varies. It depends. Like, say, for instance, a child says someone in their family did that. If they bring that up, if you say something like that, the parents sometimes in disbelief and things of that nature. Or if it's someone in school, they're, of course, they're quick to talk about and try to understand what's going on. But that's what I see normally in that sense. It could be very overprotective and try to do everything possible to find out who that individual was. But the most difficult thing is when it comes from someone that they knew or grew up with. You know, are you familiar with the term grooming?
Mm-hmm. But please explain to our audience what grooming means.
Grooming is the process of building a relationship and preparing a child for a planned sexual assault or abuse, or what have you. And doing grooming, the perpetrator, you know, deliberately misrepresents moral or behavior standards. And they often exploit a child's need for adult approval or affection, you know, like games or interest in material awards or money or presents and things of that nature. So oftentimes when it comes to individuals that they know personally, that's what's been happening. They've been groomed for that. And then when the assault takes place, the child feels a little bit confused exactly what happened. So for the most part, the response of the parents, it's neither here or there. It's either high or low, because as I mentioned earlier, that's a very hard topic to talk about. So I'm just at the protocols and process and procedures actually set so that the people can get the resources and the help that is needed.
So if an outcry is made by a student off campus and the abuser is another student, what is the process? Well, is the process the same to report the sexual assault? So it's the same? All right.
I mentioned earlier, we have a department who actually handles that. Mm-hmm. And school districts have the exact same thing because it's legal, you know. There's only thing that we can do is make the report and actually make sure that they get the support that is needed, especially the emotional support, because that's the biggest thing. They still have to deal with that traumatic event that happened to them. And going from day to day, doing their everyday procedures or routines is a little bit difficult once that's been open or talked about openly.
So let's switch gears real quick to Title IX. What is Title IX? And this is for Hannah.
Title IX is the most commonly used name or term for the federal civil rights law. It's a part of the Education Amendments Act from 1972, and it prohibits sex-based discrimination in any school or any other education program that receives funding from the federal government. So public schools receive funding from the federal government. Most times private schools do too. When we're talking about the university level, anyone who has a student getting FAFSA, which is most students, that's federal funding. So it protects against sex-based harassment at those places.
So why is Title IX so important?
So Title IX is important. One is because it protects students from, it says, you know, sex-based harassment, which includes sexual assault, is not okay in places of education. And also so you have the law and then you have the guidance from the administrations that's set from the Department of Education that says, you know, this is how we want you to implement Title IX. And it talks about, you know, immediately reporting and immediately investigating and giving notice to the parents and creating interim measures. So while we're investigating, there's protections for the students, whether that be a stay away order or counseling. It allows for all those things so that students can feel safe at school. And then if for some reason a student is not safe because, or they've, you know, already been violated, how can we continue to protect them so they can, you know, get their education in a safe way?
So that's pretty much what Title IX is like. That's the impact for the students, is to provide the protection.
Mm-hmm.
And then you also, again, said Title IX protects school-age children, universities. Does it protect any other educational levels besides those? Or is it just strictly just school-age, school-age, which is kindergarten, middle school, high school, and then college? Does it go outside of that?
Yeah, it does. So it applies to anyone who receives an education from an educational program. So, you know, K through 12 and college are like the big things that we think of when we think of school. But it also covers trade schools, cosmetology school. Like I said, it can include a private school if the private school receives any type of federal funding, like one penny worth of federal funding. So I would feel comfortable saying that most private schools would be covered under Title IX.
Right.
And then it also includes libraries or museums if they're if they're getting public funding and they're offering educational services. So a kindergartner in public school, and also a person in their late 50s going back to nursing school for a second degree, are both equally covered under Title IX. Now, K through 12, you know, Title IX is different for K through 12 and university, but Title IX applies to both of those examples.
That's awesome. So what does Title IX prohibit against?
So it prohibits against sex-based harassment. What is sex-based harassment? I would say it's that same thing that we talked about earlier in the FFI policy. So some specific examples is physical assault that's of a sexual nature. So like inappropriate touching. I would say that probably grooming could be considered that too, if a teacher was grooming a student. Also bullying based on sex. So if a student is transgender and they're being dead named, or they're being outed, or they're being bullied because of their gender identity. It also covers sexual orientation. So same things, if a student was being bullied because their sexual orientation, that could include inappropriate things happening in the locker room. Those Title IX prohibits against sex-based discrimination, and all those things I just listed are sex-based discrimination.
And then the person doing that discrimination doesn't necessarily have to be an adult. It can be from children as well, correct?
That's right. And actually in my practice, I have not had a case where it's been a teacher or an adult on student. I usually see student on student harassment.
Okay. And then how does Title IX play into the reporting process?
So Title IX lays out the requirements for how a school should respond once they are notified or once a report of sexual harassment or sexual assault is made. And the general rule is that they need to immediately investigate. And then they also need to immediately provide interim measures, is what Title IX calls it. But that's the stay away order, or which, you know, in K through 12 could be a schedule change. So if there's a student on student harassment and the students have classes together, it may be a schedule change, which is further complicated if a student is a special education student with an IEP. It's harder, you know, you can't just automatically make a schedule change. I think a lot of people think that it's easy for a school to make a schedule change. And while I wish it was, I know that I recognize that it's not that simple. But things like that, that's how Title IX plays into the reporting process, is it lays out what the school needs to do immediately. And then also what the school needs to, you know, how long the school needs to do that by, what happens once the school's wrapped up their investigation, the notice requirements. So when you file a report of sexual harassment or sexual assault, the school has to notify the perpetrator. And so, you know, how do we do that within the confines of FERPA, which is the privacy laws that schools are bound by? And how much of that, you know, what does the perpetrator have a right to know and to respond to? So Title IX lays out all those things, and it's different for K through 12 and college. I know today we're focusing on K through 12, but I just want to mention that when we're talking about the college level, there could be a hearing versus at K through 12, we're not really seeing hearings. We're seeing investigations that are, and the perpetrator and the student survivor are not usually, you know, talking to each other about it.
So what are, okay, and this is something I was just thinking about. So does Title IX have any penalties or consequences if the school does not act according to Title IX policies?
Yeah, so you can file a complaint with the Office of Civil Rights. That's under the Department of Education. You usually need to file that within about 6 months of the incident happening, so you can't come back 2 years later and file it. And then also Title IX has a private right of action. So you can file a lawsuit against a school for not following Title IX. And then also, like I mentioned, that FFI policy, schools also have an FNG policy. Same thing, FNG doesn't stand for anything, but that's what schools or parents and students can file if they have a grievance with the school. And so the parent could file an FNG complaint saying the school didn't file the FFI report. And then this parent or student can go through that internal school process. And again, that's on the Texas Association of School Boards has an FNG policy for most public school districts. So you could pull that and it would tell you, you know, this is who for this school, I'm not happy with how they did the sexual assault investigation. So I'm filing an FNG complaint. And then you're asking the principal or the superintendent to remedy what happened.
Very interesting. Title IX is detailed and a lot.
Yeah.
But again, it's good that it gives protections, you know, for school age children too, who are dealing with sexual assault and sexual harassment. So in a situation where the abuser is not a student and the child makes an outcry to a school employee, what are the obligations of the school and the employee?
I would say that the same rule applies. And I think Drew also mentioned that earlier, that with for legally, the same rule applies, whether it's a student on student or a teacher on student or off of campus. I think that if the campus is aware, if they receive direct or indirect notice that a student has experienced prohibited conduct, then they should, you know, immediately notify that appropriate district official, which is the Title IX coordinator. And every district has a Title IX coordinator. In bigger districts, there may be like a Title IX coordinator specific for elementary and specific for middle school. In smaller districts, there's maybe just one Title IX coordinator for the whole district, but every school district in Texas has a Title IX coordinator, and that's the person that should be notified no matter where it happened and no matter who perpetrated the misconduct. It should be same rule.
So basically, because Andrew, you mentioned it earlier, so basically the Title IX coordinator is in the office of the one that handles the investigation in regards to the sexual assault, sexual harassment. Okay, so that's the separate agency. So basically y'all need to, so if it's known, and then we just want clarification purposes. So if an employee knows on school, somebody on school knows, then they should report it to the Title IX coordinator. Like no ifs, and buts, don't go past go straight there. So then when a parent finds out about the sexual assault but refuses services, whether the abuser is a student or not, you mentioned this before, then what are the next steps?
Let's see. Well, it's up to investigation. I mean, at the end of the day, it's all about keeping the child safe, right? So it's on their court where I do not know. I'm going to be honest with you. I do not know exact particular that answer in particular. However, that's why we have that organization or that coordinator for that. For the most part, you do see that sometimes, and I don't know any personal experiences of what happened as far as parents not accepting what's going on. So I can't actually talk about that in a sense, but that's, you'll find that a lot that's happening. And at the end of the day, it's shit about making sure the child is okay, or that student is okay, and making sure they get the help that's needed for them, period.
Have you, in your experience, Hannah, parents refuse services to protect their child, or once they find out, or do they just tend to just like come to y'all for needing services?
Yeah, I mean, I think just because the nature of being a lawyer, that for me, people are coming to me because they want services. Mm-hmm. So I have not seen somebody refuse services. I mean, I guess I've seen, you know, we ask for ABC and the school says, I'll only do A. And so in that sense, the parent's like, well, that's not enough. But I haven't seen a parent say, you know, no, I don't want anything.
What supportive services does the school offer for student survivors in a situation in which the abuser is not a student and law enforcement and CPS has been notified?
Okay, first off, just getting them familiarized with children's advocacy centers. Connecting a child with a CAC is, for the most part, open to trauma, involves to mental health, medical, and family advocacy supports that are available. And long as we'll just give a list of supports they have access to, and it's up on them to actually use that. But for the most part, that's what it is. Any type of medical, mental health, family centers, and important role is just facilitating communication between those partners to assist, coordinate everything to make sure everything is okay. So for the most part, I do know we do have that. We do and provide tons of support for individuals in that situation. They have that available for them. And as I mentioned earlier, on top of handling everything or sending everything to a Title IX coordinator, our counseling services have tons of support that is really available for those individuals who experience things of that.
How often is sexual assault reported to the schools in any of these scenarios? Like, how often are they reported?
Wow. There's not, I don't have any statistics and things of that nature. I can go from.
Well, let me clarify. Is it more over-reported, under-reported, or kind of just middle of the road?
It's middle of the road for the most part. We have a lot more cases when it comes to bullying, if that's the case. Hmm. But sexual assault or things of that nature is right in the middle of the road in a sense.
Are you getting, when you get the, let me say this, those that are not reported, do y'all tend to see more signs before there's reported?
And that's the thing. And once you recognize the signs, you know, we're just talking. The biggest thing is, as I mentioned earlier, is a trust factor. It's a trust factor in making sure individuals feel safe. And even though they may not say anything at that time, long as you establish that rapport and that relationship with that person, and then making them just feel safe, you never know what they may indulge and talk to you about. So at the end of the day, it's all about making sure that relationship is okay with that person. And if they feel as the time, like, we should not, like, you know, interrogate and things of that nature and ask all these intimidating questions per se, we just got to make sure that the environment is safe for them to discuss it if they choose to talk about it at that time. But if we do recognize the signs, it's our job to actually just talk and make sure that, you know, how they're feeling and things are okay and go from there.
What are some of the reasons why students don't report sexual assault?
Afraid of what their parents or loved ones may say. Honestly, that's what you see. And case in point, sometimes if they do say something, they may take it back. And we know there's, you know, sometimes that happens, but we just need to understand that. We just got to make sure that they have the space to actually talk about things. But yeah, it's like that all the time. I can talk from experience. For me, I was scared. I didn't want to talk about it. I didn't want anything happening to the individuals that could have done that or what have you. And I'm pretty sure it could be the same with some other individuals.
Right, protecting the abuser.
I would also add that I think a lot of times students don't know that they are a survivor of sexual assault. I think that younger people, like students, may be under the impression that if it's not rape by penetration, then it's not sexual assault. But that's not the case. There's other forms of sexual assault. And so I think that some survivors may not even realize that they're a survivor of sexual assault because they don't realize that you can be sexually assaulted and it not, you know, not have been penetrated.
Is that something that, and I mean, this is just, can it be taught in the classroom what sexual assault is, Andrew? Like, are students made aware, can students be made aware that it's not just penetration is considered sexual assault?
We have several guidance lessons conducted by our counselors that talk about that. Mm-hmm. And to be honest with you, sometimes depending on what the situation is, doing community circles, we probably talk about things of that nature. But for the most part, it's common for children and youth to delay telling somebody about it because, you know, they don't want to feel like a snitch. You know how that is. They're really worried about telling, or they would, upset the individuals in their life or what have you. They'd probably be protecting, as you mentioned earlier, Hannah, about the adult or that person that did that. And they feel like sometimes that they saying something like that will actually cause a family disruption of things. And like understanding and talking about that can be difficult for children and younger individuals because of the developmental disabilities, depending on their developmental stage at that time. So yeah, we find it's a difficult topic to talk about. And as I mentioned earlier, it's very important for us to make sure we just create a safe environment so they can open up if they choose to.
So what are some resources for parents after they find out their child is a victim of sexual assault?
Hey, as I mentioned earlier, the Children Advocacy Centers, that for the most part has everything. That goes to Child Protective Services, CPI, CPS, Adult Protective Services, of course. Mental health, hospitals and things of that nature. But as I mentioned earlier, just facilitating the coordination between the two, that's the biggest thing. So our counselors provide information to the parents if they ask for it, and it's there for them at the time.
What are some resources for the student who is the victim of sexual assault?
Let's see, therapy. Therapy, types of therapy, depending on their age and where they are developmentally and the capacity to understand what's happening. So play therapy, optimal for them. Trauma-focused cognitive behavioral therapy is available if that's needed. Also, child welfare, they have information like all that through our Title IX coordinator that has all that extra information as well. So there's tons of resources that are available for students or individuals if they need that.
And Even outside the school, there's resources too. So the schools have great resources when it comes to counseling within, you know, the 9-to-5 school day. But there's also, you know, community or faith-based resources. So maybe at your synagogue or church, maybe if you go to like the Boys and Girls Club after school, I think that there's also resources outside of the school that the school usually directs people to. And there's also support groups online, support groups in person, both for parents of the student and the student.
And then now, Hannah, I want you to talk a little bit about, because you, as you and I, we both deal with, you know, these type of cases when they come to us and but the children is our client. But explain that process about, you know, how we handle those sexual assault cases. And it's the children that's the client, but they're underage. And then we still have to deal with the parent.
Wow.
Yeah. So depending on the age of the student is how I determine if I'm going to have a like attorney client relationship with the parent or the child or the student. So, you know, if the student is in elementary school and younger and has a disability, then I probably need to have the parent as the client because the parent is the one who is guiding the advocacy. When I have a student who is in high school or middle school and they can speak for themselves, You know, they may need their parent to help them sign the release forms to me so that I can get the school records, but I have the student be the client. And so for me, I look at the age, the capacity, and also at the relationship between the parent and the student. So I haven't had this come up, but I think that if the abuser was somebody in the family, that I may be more likely to represent the student because the parent's interest could be adverse to the student. And at the end of the day, my goal is to protect the student, whether that be, you know, advocating through the parent or the student's well-being is the goal. So that would affect my decision on whether to have the parent or the student be the client. And then, you know, there's additional barriers when the student is the client because, you know, the students may have a cell phone depending on their age, but a lot of times you're calling the parent to get through to the student or, you know, you're explaining things to the student, but you know, it's legal jargon and even the parent may have a hard time understanding it, but they're in a better place to understand it than the student. And so there are hard parts about representing a student instead of a parent, but at the end of the day, I would look at, you know, what's best for the student.
And so we talked about resources for the student and the parents that are the victims of sexual assault. Are there any resources out there for the abuser's parents? And and any resources for the abusers when the abuser is a minor?
There are, and that's difficult question. It's a difficult conversation because when it's a student on student, you have a minor who was assaulted, but you also have a minor who did the assaulting. And I would say that, and I don't have a statistic, but I think that if there is a minor who is sexually assaulting someone else, that minor is likely also a survivor of sexual assault by someone else. They probably mm-hmm. learned that behavior from someone else. That's something that I would think. So I think it's very important to get the abuser resources. Now, if I represent the survivor, I'm probably not advocating for the abuser. I'm definitely not advocating against them, of course, to receive counseling. But I think that it's just as important for the abuser, especially as a minor, to get counseling. You know, there are therapies specific for people who engage in sexual assault. So I think those would be helpful. And then I think parents too, you know, supporting a parent who's in that position, I think is really important through counseling, through support groups and things like that.
Well, thank you all for this great conversation. Like I said, I feel like it's a conversation that needs to be had because school is getting ready to start up in a few weeks. So thank y'all for being a guest. If you are a victim or survivor or you know somebody, do not suffer in silence. Please reach out. There's resources for parents, there's resources for students. Even though, like we said, you know, students may be scared and not know what to do, there are people out there to help you. So Hannah, please let everybody know if they're in the San Antonio or Central Texas area, how can they reach Trala?
That's a good question. I should have our intake line pulled up. So you can call us Monday through Friday, I think it's 9 to 5, and to do an intake. And our intake line is 956-996-TRLA. So that's 956-996-8752. And you can do an intake that way, Monday through Friday, 9 to 5 Central Time.
And just tell everybody what service areas y'all handle.
Yes, that's a good point too. So we cover from Austin all the way south to the border and then from El Paso to Sinton. So it's Central Texas and South Texas. And actually on our website, you can go and you can look on the counties and you can see what's in TRLA service area versus what's LANWIT, Legal Aid of Northwest Texas, and Lone Star Legal Aid. So you could see based on the county you live in, which legal aid covers you because all counties in Texas are covered by a legal aid, whether it be Brandi's or mine or the third legal aid.
And then Andrew, thank you again. I know, I mean, you're with the school district, so people can't really reach out to you. you just keep taking care of our children.
Try to do all we can. At the end of the day, it's all about the kids and making sure we setting them up for success in their future endeavors. So that's why we're in it, right?
Right. And if you need legal advice or any resources, we are within 72 counties. So we handle like Houston, Harris County, Fort Bend. Well, let me say this: Harrison Continuous Counties plus Jefferson County, all over too. So you can contact us at 1-800-733-8394. Again, if do not suffer in silence. If you have a child who has experienced sexual assault and you do not know what to do, please reach out. Please tell the school. There is plenty of resources out there and available. So thank you again. And until next time.
Thank you.
Thank you for the time.